the microphone should go pow at us. We'll start working on it and get it back to normal, hopefully, next week. Thank you to all of those who sent money and supported the Deacons Fund. We've raised a good bit of money, and I know that Marnie and her family are grateful for not just the outpouring of funds, but the outpouring of love that this community is showing her. So thank you, Beach. We also are going to have a congregational meeting for February 13th. So if you had early Valentine's plans, just cancel them now. It's going to be a long, long meeting. It'll be a nice, easy meeting. Hopefully, we'll present the budget. You're more than welcome to ask questions. We were talking about how sometimes these just go, yep, yep, yep. But truly, if you have questions about the budget, we want to know, and we hope we can answer them. And if not, we'll find the answer for you. I also wanted to tell you each thank you for sending Casey so many happy birthday wishes. She is in bed today. She got a job, and so she's going to start cooking at the Upper Crust Bakery on Monday. Oh. Yeah! So go see her, say hi. And then she also, in the meantime, accidentally said yes to pulpit supplying for Gowanda 5 weeks in a row. So she said, I think I'm going to not go to church this morning, but tell them I said hello. So hello from Casey and our cold family. Friends, I also hope that each of you were not too cold last night. I know that some of you had power and some of you didn't, and glad to see you here this morning. If you're watching online because you didn't have power last night, hello, and nobody blames you. So friends, let us use this moment, this hour, this time in our lives to worship God.
Please rise in body or spirit as we call ourselves to worship. People of God, the divine mystery is all around us. With hospitality, let us turn our attention to this mystery.
We welcome unfamiliar ideas. We try to be open to surprising revelations. We celebrate that we can't and don't know it all.
People of God, there is freedom in letting go of the need to be certain. May this service help us.
That fresh wisdom may emerge, love may deepen, and paths of the collective curiosity emerge.
Come. Let us worship God. Be seated, thank you. God has filled our lives with wisdom and surrounded us with divine messengers. In thanksgiving for many ways we hear and see those messengers, let us offer our gifts. If you'd like to offer to the church, you may leave your offering as a plate near the table in the front or scan the QR code. For the gifts of words, prayers, wisdom, and funds given throughout the week and today, let us pray the prayer of thanksgiving together, saying,
We pray our community becomes a faithful and trustworthy friend to all your prophets and wisdom. Bless this offering to furthering the good news in all of its freeing forms. Amen.
I will sing hymn number 687. This is one and two.
Our Lord, our Redeemer, Jesus Christ, our hope.
opportunity to receive God's mercy and share in that abundant grace. This is not about guilt. This is about love, justice, hope, and of course, grace. Confident in God's love for us, God's grace offered to us, and the abundance of hope that surrounds us, let us offer our prayers of confession first in silence. Explored grace for a brief 30 seconds. Let us join our voices together to seek healing as a community. May the work that we do here in this confession be a 30-second moment that reaches out into the world and becomes our life. So let us confess together, saying,
God of great expectations, you know how easy it is for us to make excuses for inactivity. We love to run and hide when a task is set before us. We look at the expectation and think that we don't have the abilities, strength, or wisdom to accomplish this task. We think too often that we are doing these things all by ourselves. And we feel sorry for ourselves and angry that you expect so much from us. Forgive our ignorance, O Lord. Help us to understand that the opportunities for service that you offer to us also come with your guiding presence, love, and support. It is your love which makes the impossible possible. Let our work be part of the fulfillment of Jesus' work. Amen.
Friends in Christ, know this. The mercy of God is from everlasting to everlasting. And may this momentary part of Sunday worship remind you of this surpassing grace. In Jesus Christ, because you live and because you walk on this earth, you are forgiven. Alleluia, amen, and may all God's people say, amen.
Now the word of the Lord came to me, saying, before I formed you in the womb, I knew you, and before you were born, I consecrated you. I appointed you a prophet to the nations. Then I said, ah, Lord God, truly I do not know how to speak, for I am only a boy. But the Lord said to me, do not say, I am only a boy, for you shall go to all to whom I send you, and you shall speak whatever I command you. Do not be afraid of them, for I am with you to deliver you, says the Lord. Then the Lord put out his hand and touched my mouth. And the Lord said to me, now I have put my words in your mouth. See, today I appoint you over nations and over kingdoms, to pluck up and to pull down, to destroy and to overthrow, to build and to plant. Here ends our reading.
This is one of those Sundays where all of the lectionary was so good. good, and it was so hard to choose which one to preach about. So I went with Corinthians because sometimes you just need a little bit of love infused into your life. But if you would like to follow up on the Luke lectionary, it's the story right after the one we read last week, and it's also worthy of your hearing. But now let us turn to 1 Corinthians 13, 1 through 13. If I speak in the tongues of mortals and of angels, but do not have love, I am a noisy gong or a clanging cymbal. And if I have prophetic powers and understand all mysteries and all knowledge, and if I have all faith so as to remove mountains but do not have love, I am nothing. If I give away all my possessions and if I hand over my body that I may boast but do not have love, I gain nothing. Love is patient. Love is kind. Love is not envious or boastful or arrogant or rude. It does not insist on its own way. It is not irritable or resentful. It does not rejoice in wrongdoing, but rejoices in the truth. It bears all things, believes all things, hopes all things, endures all things. Love never ends. But as for prophecies, they will come to an end. As for tongues, they will cease. As for knowledge, it will come to an end. For we know only in part as we prophesy, only in part. But when the complete comes, the partial will come to an end. When I was a child, I spoke like a child. I thought like a child. I reasoned like a child. And when I became an adult, I put an end to childish ways. For now we see in a mirror dimly, but then we will see face to face. Face to face. Now I know only in part, then I will know fully, even as I have already been more fully known. And now faith, hope, and love abide these three, and the greatest gift is love. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Oh, Paul, isn't he clever and wonderful and annoying? Shared a story a couple of months ago that stuck with me and reminded me of needing to be self-aware, which is what I feel like Paul is doing here, is asking people to be self-aware and couching it in this grand thing that no one can grasp called love. The pastor writes, on a flight to Europe, during that brief moment where COVID seemed to be going away, she got in line for the restroom on the plane, but after waiting and then knocking and knocking, she and another person decided they needed to call a flight attendant. And they did indeed find someone close to unconsciousness in the restroom. At this point, she and the other woman were kind of, you know, on an airplane, it's already awkward. She was pinned into a strange spot and they couldn't get back to their seats. They were kind of relegated to the emergency standing aisle. And they were trying to get out of the way. They were trying really hard so that people could do their work, so the doctor could get in there and take care of this person. But there were two people praying, oblivious to the sounds and the fury of the humanity around them, just praying in their own little world. They didn't seem to care about the person in the bathroom or these two women who were awkwardly trying to stay out of the way. She said these two grown men were taking up a lot of space. In a story like this, it's impossible not to see where religion, where praying took precedence over people, and where piety took up more space than love took up for others. But of course, you know it's coming. Religious people have been just as good at taking up space since religion was a thing. The Corinthians, the Christians, were the ones taking up a whole lot of room. Taking up room with doing things well and beautifully, so invested in their adorable check marks of who was better and who knew more and who was the bigger, better, stronger Christian. They were so impressed with their faith and their hope that they forgot the greatest of these is love. Now, for a lot of people, this passage written to the Corinthians is wedding jargon, a beautiful, flowery passage about marriage. And it absolutely can be and should be. And it can absolutely and should part. Love, marriage, people are not always romantic. Love is patient, not easy. And this passage does say many a nice thing about the emotion, the noun and verb of love. But Paul did not intend for this to be flowery. He intended it to interrupt the church at Corinth, to shake them, to upset them even. He wanted them to stand at the back of the sanctuary, hold their offerings from them, and glare at him and talk on him, about him on the way out. That was his purpose. Sometimes we pastors do that. Not this one. Not today. Why? They did this because they liked how things were. It was the way society always worked. They kept doing their old way of being, and then they just added Jesus to their studies. They added Jesus to their hierarchical society. Let's just fit Jesus in with caste systems and patriarchy and ageism. Let's just put him in to where we know. It's not their fault. Humanity just seems to work that way. They kept their old life and added in there are new things. Brilliant. It's basically like the whole 30 diet. The first 30 days of January, you change your life. You absolutely change your life. And then it's the Super Bowl. You know that bison dip is coming out. You don't want to change that much. You've done your 30 days. Let's fit back in to where society has me. What they didn't get was that Christianity wasn't just this moment in time, a jump start to a diet. Something they didn't get was that it comes all the time, constantly. It's so much easier to not have to do things differently. I am not preaching to you. I'm preaching to me, too. This is hard stuff to change. It's so much easier to just change surface things, right, and pat yourselves on the back, like, oh, what are we doing in churches these days? We'll call this the gathering place. Get rid of that antiquated word sanctuary, and then all the young people will come because we've renamed it. But we don't want to actually change the way we gather. There are times when our individual or collective understanding of God, the faith and the hope part, becomes so narrow that we can no longer recognize the religion we formed, no longer recognize what we've attached ourselves to and why, no longer recognize who we've let in, who we've kicked out. We just don't see it anymore. And that's why we need Paul and his annoying, brilliant, beautiful self to continue to inspire us, to remind us, to put us back in the moment of Corinth. There's a Presbyterian church in Fairfax, Virginia that recently, get this, knocked its perfectly fine church building down and in its place built affordable housing for retired folks and people who needed assisted living. They made a multifunctional church on the bottom floors and living space on top of it and had an open center all day long. That's a lot of change. That's a lot of letting go of the ideas of church. That's a lot of pain. That's a lot of frustration, a lot of money, a lot of heated discussions and hurt feelings. That's a lot of love. But my Uncle Barnaby, that was his pulpit. No more. Because they had to love people over losing stained glass. They had to love the future of their congregation over loving their 1945-era baptismal font. They were able to move on. What is love anyway? Love, as you know, isn't always pretty. Love of country can find you in a minefield in Afghanistan. Love can find you fighting your child as you place her in the arms of drug rehab. Love can find you trying to understand your husband's wish to stop chemo. Love can find you rethinking your retirement. Love can ask you to really see someone's new identity. Love can make you uncomfortable. It can make you unsure. It can make you vulnerable. No, I'll stick to faith and hope and love what I already know. Thanks anyway, Paul. Love, it's not so easily defined. If you do some digging, you'll find that love has its roots in the word womb. Isn't that cool? Don't you love nerding out on language with me? Love is found in the word womb. Just like the passage from Jeremiah, the womb offers birth. To love is to bring something into the world and all the pain that goes with it. But in the end, there is a life-giving quality to love, something Jesus shows on his way to and from the cross. What will it take for us to stop taking up space and instead giving it to others, we Christians? Amazon Video has sections with different categories, and one is Black Voices, where recently they've had several movies and documentaries. Did I say that right? Documentaries? Documentaries. About the Green Book. Do you know the Green Book?
Yes.
Some of you? It was created by a male man who noticed that space was being taken up. During the Jim Crow law era, Vincent Green started hearing story after story of black families not being able to travel very easily. Before he was a Texas senator, one man remembers having a college meeting in Waco. He and three of his white female classmates from the University of Houston drove from Houston to Waco. And as someone who has driven that, even modern days, it is a lot of backwoods, and I'm scared of a couple of those towns, and I am not joking. But the only way he was allowed to eat lunch was if the girls told the restaurants that they hired a boy to drive them. There are stories of families who were allowed to purchase gas, but not allowed to use the restroom. Stories of families having to sleep in cars, and worse and worse and worse. So Mr. Green made a travel guide telling black families where they could eat, use the restroom, find a hotel, pump gas, and which towns to completely avoid altogether. The guide was indeed a huge hit and probably saved lives. He wrote in the introduction to each year's guide, "There will come a day when we no longer need this guide." And then, one day, the NAACP turned to the travel guides and said, "This is how we do this. We tell stories to make law happen." They introduced the Civil Rights Act in a hot, muggy July on the day before Congress was set to leave. Smart. They traveled back to their own families on those hot, long, boring roads. What would it look like, they asked Congress, if you took your daughter on a trip? Where can you get her a soda? And then, when she's had too many sodas, where can she use the restroom? Where will you find respite from the heat and feed your family and pump gas? For the first time, white lawmakers started to understand how love works. You have to stop taking up space and let others in for the sake of love. You have to put an end to the old ways of doing things and do the hard, bold, uncomfortable work of making room. People like Vincent Green loved their community, strangers even, so much that he birthed an idea, a social network to keep people safe. And that birth created life for a movement. And that story created the Civil Rights Act. Because it takes a long time for change, 2 years after the Civil Rights Act was introduced, the Green Book finally stopped production. This is the hard work of what you and I do, knowing that we're good. Maybe that we haven't done this, but it's good to know our history. Because I guarantee that we need to claim that there were Christians turning away black families. I guarantee there were pastors who thought it their duty to take up white space. I guarantee there were Christians so focused on their way of life, their faith, and their hope that they missed love. They thought they could get away with loving God and themselves and their own people and no one else. Corinthians. Love is patient. Love is kind. It bears all things, believes all things, hopes all things, endures all things. None of that sounds easy, but it does sound worthy, life-changing, womb-bearing work. And so, even if we're not who we were in the 60s or the 70s, the 80s, the 90s, the 2000s even, may we continue to point ourselves back at the Corinthians and say, where are we taking up room and not letting others see our love? May we take up less room. May we welcome love. And may we bear it all together. One faith, one family, one hope, one mind.
Mine is kind of a reaction to your sermon, that each of us, out of concern, think of a person that just kind of annoys us. You know, not the person that's really despicable, not Adolf Eichmann or anything, but the person that just annoys us, and that we try to be a little more loving.
I like that. For anybody who didn't hear, Rosie says during this prayer that we think of anybody who annoys us, not necessarily our most enemy, but just somebody who annoys us, and think of them and pray for them during this hour. Well, I give thanks that the college kids are back. I believe. Let us go to God in prayer. You, God, Lord and Sovereign. You, God, Lover and Partner. You are God of all our possibilities. You preside over all our comings and goings, all our wealth and all our poverty, all our sickness and all our health, all our despair and all our hope, all our living and all our dying. We are grateful. You are God of all our impossibilities, turning them into possibilities. You have presided over the emancipations of healings of our mothers and fathers. You have presided over the wondrous transformations in all our lives, the times when we've been asked to grow. You have and will preside over those parts of our lives that we imagine to be closed or do not know yet. And we are grateful. So be your true self, enacting the things impossible for us, that we might yet be whole among the blind who see, and the dead who are raised, that we may yet witness your will for peace, your vision for justice, your vetoing of all our places without love. At the outset of this day, we place our lives in your hands. Before the end of this day, do newness among us in the very places where we are tired, where we have fear, where we are exhausted, where we have guilt, where we have spent anxiety. Make all things new in those places and beyond. Help us throw flowers, not bombs. Help us make room, not lines. Help us add leaves to the table as Jesus encourages us to grow, and as we say together, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever.
Thank you.
Let us go in peace.